صلاتي واتم التسليم على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اجمعين. It is truly a joy, and when I say that, I'm not just saying it, I really mean it. I want to be back here again with all of you, welcoming another Ramadan. And I think a great way to welcome Ramadan is through these halaqat that we hold, through these lectures, trying to understand the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I want to start off with a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was speaking to people whose most precious possession or the height of luxury or what marked, you know, wealth and comfort and prosperity in class was to actually have camels. That was like the biggest mark of you know, luxury and riches at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he says that once the Prophet came to some of his companions, you know, the Ashab al-Kufa, they were extremely poor companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So richness and wealth and luxury has a totally different type of appeal, a greater appeal to those that are poor. So this is what he said to them sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أَيُّكُمْ يُحِبُّ أَنْ يَدْخُلَ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ إِلَى بُطْحَانَ أَوْ إِلَى الْعَقِيقِ فَيَأْتِي مِنْهُ بِنَاقَتَيْنِ. Okay, so here the Prophet is addressing his companions, and he's saying, "Which one of you would like to go out in the morning every day to Bukhar or Al-Aqib?" These are two different places that the Prophet identifies. And he says, "Wayati minhu binaqatayn qawmawayn." Okay, qawmawayn, yani he's saying, he's describing these two places in Medina, and he's saying, "Who would like to go there and bring back two large she camels?" So again, alluding to what was considered, you know, the most luxurious possession a person could have. Qawmawayn fi ghayri ikram walaqatirrahim, which means to be able to accrue this, to be able to attain these without involving any sin or severing or severing of family ties. فَقُلْنَا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ نُحِبُّ ذَلِكَ. And so they responded, "O Messenger of Allah, we would like that." So he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the reason I'm sharing this hadith is to put in perspective what we're doing here in these halaqat, in these lectures. فَقُلْنَا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ نُحِبُّ ذَلِكَ قَالَ أَفَلَا يَغْلُوا أَحَدُكُمْ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ فَيَعْلَمُ أَوْ يَقْرَأُ آيَتَيْنِ مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ نَاقَتَيْنِ وَثَلَاثٌ خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ أَوْ أَرْبَعٌ خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ أَرْبَعٍ وَمِنْ أَعْدَادِهِنَّ مِنْ الْإِبِلِ. And he said, "For one of you to go to the masjid in the morning and learn or recite two verses from the Book of Allah is better than two she camels, and three are better than three, and four better than four, and so on." So the Prophet ﷺ here is putting in perspective any worldly gain a person could attain that is very attractive, especially when someone is poor. To attain something out of dunya, compare that to getting two or three or four verses of the Quran, yani learning them, reciting them. This is far more precious, far more valuable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, something that will be heavy on the scales of the Day of Judgment. So this is why we're here today. You know my style, I don't do a lot of verses. My goal is not to finish the surah, to finish the Quran. My goal is really to try to understand and appreciate and enjoy the richness and the lessons of each verse. So if we're here only to do two, three, four, five surahs, the wealth that we can attain from that cannot be rivaled by, like the Prophet ﷺ said, بِنَاقَتَيْنِ قَوْمَاوَيْنِ. Okay, so here, with that, inshallah, we're going to, just wanted to share about the month of the Qur'an, which is the month that we are in, the month of Ramadan. What a blessing it is that we were able to make it to this month. Many of you may know people who died just before Ramadan. And subhanAllah, this happens every year. And I think it's a sign that Allah sends to us, to the living, to appreciate the blessing of witnessing Ramadan again. And this is what the Prophet and his companions would actually make dua 6 months before Ramadan for Allah to allow them to live to see the next Ramadan. This is how eager and keen they were to meet this, to witness the month, because they knew of the opportunity and the potential that lies within this month. So here is another honor, a blessing to have this opportunity to reflect and gain, make gains on the with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to reflect on the book that makes the month what it is. Ramadan would not be Ramadan the way it is for us if the Quran had not been revealed in it. Right? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. This is what makes the month. Ramadan is what it is. It has the status that it has because of the book that Allah revealed in this month. No other month has this distinction. And if you think about it, why we fast in Ramadan? Why don't we fast in the other months? Why don't we fast in the Hijjah or in the other months, which are the sacred months, right? Ramadan is not even one of the four sacred months. Why do we fast in this month? It is said that there is no other worship that we can possibly perform to come close to expressing the gratitude that is due for the blessing of the Quran. So since the Quran is revealed in this month, there's no other way that you can express gratitude for this immense blessing except by the worship of fasting, except by this very unique ibadah of fasting. So however it is that you are attached to the Book of Allah, whether it is through recitation of the Quran, whether it is through tafsir, these tafsir sessions that we'll be having, whether you are memorizing the Quran, mashallah, this Friday is our sister's Hifz graduation, so all of you are invited to come. Many of our sisters, mashallah, are graduating with various parts of the Quran, having memorized them since last fall. So some are involved in Hifz. Many of you are attending the Taraweeh. Whatever capacity you are engaged in with the Quran, I want you to remember the words of Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu when he said, لَوْ طَهُرَتْ قُلُوبُنَا مَا شَبَعَتْ مِنْ كَلَامِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Beautiful statement from Uthman radiallahu anhu where he said that were our hearts to be purified, they would never tire, never become fed up with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the words of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So this is a time to test the purity of our hearts. He associates our hunger for the Quran being proportional to the purity of our hearts. The more pure our hearts are, the more our hearts will hunger for the Quran. Then it will not be enough just to recite it at home without meaning. We will want to come and know the tafsir. It will not be enough just to read it, we will want to memorize it. It will not be enough just to read it at home or this, on your own. You will want to hear it. So this is the month to really reflect on the state of our hearts and how attached our hearts are to the Quran. Do we get fed up? Do we get satisfied easily? Or is our hunger only increasing? And if it is, then inshallah this is an indication of the purity of our hearts. Now to benefit from these brief moments, subhanAllah, if you think about it, it's only a couple of weeks that we have together. We don't have any sessions in the last 10 days of Ramadan, but 5 days have already passed. So what do we really have? We only have about 10 sessions or so, or less. We don't have them on Fridays to make it easier for everyone. So it's just brief moments that we have together to really reflect on the Book of Allah and to encourage your own extensive study as well as your time here. To really benefit from your time here as well as the study you'll do at home, I want to share with you the words of Qutb al-Murad, rahimahullah ta'ala. He has a beautiful book, actually. The title of his book is the title of our Sahabah, our series, where we call it The Journey to the Quran. Actually, that's the title of his book, a beautiful book that I recommend anyone to read. And he says, and I want everyone to carefully, don't write this down, it's available online. Just think about it. You can close your eyes if you want. Just ponder and think about the words that he is saying and how you can apply them and live them, inshallah, in these brief moments that we have together. He says, as you come to the Quran, you come to a new world. No other venture in your life can be so momentous and crucial, so blissful and rewarding as your journey to and through the Quran. It is a journey that will take you through the endless joys and riches of the words that your Creator and Lord has sent down, has sent to you and all mankind. Here you will find a world of untold treasures of knowledge and wisdom to guide you on the pathways of life, to mold your thoughts and actions. In it you will find deep insights to enrich you and steer you along the right course. From it you will receive a radiant light to illuminate the deeper reaches of your soul. Here you will encounter profound emotions, a warmth to melt your heart, and bring tears running down your cheeks. It is crucial for you because as you travel to the Quran, at every step you will be summoned to choose and to commit to Allah. To read the Quran is nothing less than to live the Quran willingly, sincerely, devotedly, and totally. The outcome of your entire life depends on how you heed the call given by Allah. I'm going to repeat the statement. The outcome of your entire life depends on how you heed the call given by Allah. The journey is therefore decisive for your existence, for mankind, for the future of human civilization. End quote. This is a profound quote by Fakhr Murad. We can just spend days just, you know, discussing this quote. And this is really reminds me of the saying of Allah radiallahu anhu, that this is a nation and ummah that has been given izzah through Islam. And once we leave that, then the izzah also goes with it. So the more we are attached to the Book of Allah, to His words, the more noble we are with Him. The more precious we are in His sight, the more valuable we become through our attachment to His Book. This is why we encourage everyone to read the Quran with proper degree, to memorize the Quran, to really become people of Quran, because this directly increases your weight and your value with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and nothing else is more precious than that. This is the whole purpose of our existence, right? Okay, so since this is our third year with the Surah An-Nisa, we started Surah An-Nisa in 2013. This is our third year doing Surah An-Nisa, and Ramadan gives you an idea of the pace of the class, right? So I'm not going to go into a very detailed introduction because it is available on our YouTube channel under Surah An-Nisa. But just for those of you that are new, just to put it in perspective before we get into the actual verse we left off with last year. Number one, this is a Madani Surah, right? So this is where people are taking notes, this is where you start to take notes, right? So number one, this is a Madani Surah, comprised of 176 verses, and it is comprised of different discourses that were revealed on different occasions throughout the Madani period. And in the last 2 years of this course, we covered the first 70 verses, okay? So year one and two, we have covered the first 70 verses of Surah An-Nisa. So today we'll be beginning with verse 71. And in these past 2 years, we've seen various themes covering laws of inheritance, protecting the rights of orphans, speaks a lot about women and their rights. Contrary to public opinion, this is not the surah that allows polygamy. Rather, it's the surah that restricts polygamy to four. Okay? You have to appreciate the social context where there was no limit on the number of wives a man could have in 7th century Arabia, right? And the Arab world at that time, the world of the Prophet ﷺ before Islam, you could have as many wives as you wanted. And there was no accountability, no detailed description of their rights, etc. So this is very important for us to know that this is the surah that not the surah that necessarily allows polygamy, but it restricts polygamy. Although both are correct, but just for you to know that. And generally the surah talks about the rights and justice and mercy towards the weaker and more vulnerable segments of society. This is what the surah talks a lot about, championing the rights of those who it's so easy to neglect. The segments of society that were being ignored, that were being taken advantage of, whether it was women or orphans, etc. And this is where we have, this is where you have the inheritance laws as well. We're also going to be looking at the hypocrites in this surah. We're going to be looking at intercession, the concept of intercession, the concept of salam, and responding to the greeting with a better response, with a better salam. This is also mentioned in the surah. How to deal with hypocrites, as we mentioned. Also the issue, the fiqh issue of when you kill someone by accident, whether they're a believer, or in cases where they're a believer, as well as when you kill someone deliberately. Okay, those cases, there's fiqh points are also discussed. We also have some fiqh of salah in here, where it mentions the shortening of the prayer. Salat al-Qasr, when you shorten the prayer in a state of travel, as well as Salat al-Khawf, which alhamdulillah, we inshallah don't have to pray ever. But it is a salah that is prescribed in extreme circumstances of fear and war. So those are just some of the points that I'm mentioning, because I think that's probably going to be the general scope of the verses that we'll be covering. About verses 70 through 100, we're hoping to get through about 30 verses this Ramadan, and those are some of the topics that are going to be covered in those verses. Now, there are many, many virtues of every surah of the Quran. We obviously cannot get into all of them, but I want to add that one experience of the Prophet put into perspective to how he reacted, what his relationship and what his emotions were when these parts of this surah were recited. So this hadith that I'm about to tell you is from the Sahih of Imam Bukhari and Muslim, which means it is at the highest level of authenticity. If it's in Bukhari, it's authentic. If it's in Muslim, it's authentic. If it's in Bukhari and Muslim, this is the highest combination of authenticity that you can have. It's called Muttafaq Alayh, right? Agreed upon. Yani agreed upon by the two Sheikh, the Sheikhan, Bukhari and Muslim. So the hadith is reported on the authority of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. So Abdullah Ibn Mas'ud, the great Mufassir of the Quran, one of the scholars of the Sahaba. As you know, most of the Sahaba were not ulama, they were not scholars. However, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he was one of them. He was one of the few scholars, one of the few mufassirin of the Quran, one of the experts. And so this, and he used to recite the Quran beautifully. And you're going to appreciate that when I tell you this hadith. Because Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu anhu, says, first I'll say in Arabic, inshallah, qala li Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, iqra. قال قلت يا رسول الله أقرأ عليك وعليك أنزل القرآن قال نعم قال فقرأت سورة النساء حتى إذا انتهيت إلى هذه الآية فكيف إذا جئنا من كل أمة بشهيد وجئنا بك على هؤلاء شهيدا which is from سورة النساء verse 41 قال حسبك الآن فالتفت إليه فإذا عيناه تذرفان. So this hadith on the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, where he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said to me, iqra, recite. Now here, iqra, doesn't read what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means, is recite Qur'an to me. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, he said, O Messenger of Allah, I shall recite to you, and it was revealed, the Qur'an was revealed to you, and the Qur'an was revealed to you, by Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he recited. He was a little surprised by the request of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, nah, he said this. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved to hear the recitation of the Qur'an. And subhanAllah, it's one thing to recite the Qur'an, even if you recite it beautifully with proper tajweed, it's another experience to recite it, and it's another to listen to it, right? Mm-hmm. And that has its own taste, and it has its own enjoyment and pleasure. So he said, I began to recite Surah An-Nisa. He said, so I started reciting Surah An-Nisa again from the beginning until I got to this ayah, which is ayah number 41. And inshallah, this is the ayah we have covered last year. You can get the tafsir on YouTube, inshallah. And it means, so how will it be when we bring from every ummah a witness? And we bring you, Yani Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a witness against these people. Okay, so when the Prophet ﷺ is reminded in the recitation about how a witness will be called from every ummah to testify upon every ummah, and the Prophet ﷺ will be brought forth as a witness upon these people. Okay, and so this is something that had an emotional reaction from the Prophet ﷺ, because what did he say at that point in verse 41? He said, "Hasbuk al-an," and he stopped reciting. That's enough. Hasbuk means that's enough. So it has to be said that's enough, and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud then turned to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he saw the Prophet that his eyes were tears. He was crying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the thought of being called as a witness upon his nation sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that gives us a little bit of perspective about Surah An-Nisa and its brief introduction. And now we want to go straight into the verse we left off with, which is verse number 71 from Surah An-Nisa. So everyone please turn to verse 71 and Surah An-Nisa. بَعْدَهُ بِلَهِ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُنُوا حِذْرَكُمْ فَانْفِرُوا فُبَاتٍ أَوْ انْفِرُوا جَمِيعًا. Which means, all you who believe, be ever prepared to encounter the enemy, either advance in detachments or advance in one body as the circumstances demand. Okay, now if you have not But the tafsir for this ayah, obviously, this doesn't mean much to us. We don't really understand what it's saying. So now this is where we're going to provide context for this verse, verse 71. This was revealed in after the Battle of Uhud. Now you know from Surah Al Imran, the Muslims suffered a crushing defeat, psychologically as well as in terms of numbers, right? At the Battle of Uhud. The victory turned into defeat, which is why it was more psychologically crushing. And this had an effect on the neighboring tribes that were still not Muslim. It made them more bold in attacking the Muslim community. They saw it as an opportunity to attack the Muslims. They spread Uhud as a sign of weakness from the Muslims. So therefore, what they started doing is attacking whenever they had the opportunity. So the Muslims at this time, when this verse 71 was revealed, the Muslims were hearing rumors from different quarters of imminent attacks on them. That there might be an attack from here, there might be an attack from there. And actually this had happened to them when some tribes were so deceitful, they would actually ask for a da'i from the Sahaba to be sent to them to explain the message of Islam. This is what the Prophet also used to do, right? He would send different Sahaba to different tribes, different areas, to teach them about Islam. And then they would become Muslim, right? But what started happening at this time is that they would ask for the teacher to come and teach them about Islam, and then they would kill him. So this is because of the, after the defeat at Uhud, they were emboldened to do these types of actions. And basically what the situation looked like right now is that there was no security for Muslim lives outside of Medina. If there were Medina, this was a stronghold still, of course, this was the base, the headquarters, the camp. But outside of Medina, there was no safety now for the Muslims at this time. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah is really giving safety precautions. What is it saying? It's saying go out, when you go out, go out in small groups. Or go out altogether. What is the implication? Don't go out alone. Because this is the time where you have become a target, so it is not safe for you to go out by yourselves. So the word that is used here, فَانْفِرُوا ثُبَاتٍ أَوْ انْفِرُوا جَمِيعًا. Two options are given. Either go out, ثُبَات, and ثُبَات I'm gonna get into what that means. It's generally translated as detachments, which are basically small groups. Basically, we're being told to take the necessary precautions to dispatch or march either number one in small groups. And if you look at the tafsir, it means, yeah, when you're going out for an expedition, when you're going out to face the enemy, yeah, go out in small groups, one after the other. This is the implication of the text. You can't really get this sense from reading the translation. But if you look at the tafsir in Arabic, it gives you this sense that it's not just one group and that's it, but it's group after group going out, one after the other. Small battalions, right? This is one of the strategies Khalid ibn Walid, radiallahu anhu, used to use, right, to overwhelm the enemy. And we know he was a winner, right? Every single battle, subhanAllah, he saifullah, he was the sword of Allah, he won every single battle. And this, what some of the strategies he would use is that you don't want to give away your total number to the other side in one shot, but if you have rows of detachments coming one, and then there's a pause, and then another one comes, and then the pause, another one comes. This has a psychological impact on the other side, right? Because what it does is, it makes them uncertain about how many are coming. And each group looks like a large group, right? So this is why, this is the understanding you can only get from the Arabic. We cannot convey that through the English. If you look at the English, you can all look at your own translations. It just says detachments, right? Either advance and detachment. So you can't really get the sense of what is meant, which is for one detachment to be followed by another detachment to be followed by another detachment, right? Etc. Or the other thing was to go out all together. There's an advantage of that as well, which is sometimes you want to overwhelm the other side in one go. Especially if you know that the opposition is small. Okay, if you know that the opposition is small, then this would be beneficial to show the number in one go. But we know in the history of Islam, the Muslims have always been in the smaller number, right? They've always been less than here, the opposing side. Now, what this means, this ayah, what it's saying, yani, this is the time of the Sahaba. This is the time when the Prophet ﷺ is with them. This is the generation that the Prophet ﷺ said is the best generation. This is the generation Jibreel ﷺ sometimes would come in their midst in the form of a human being. Okay? So yani, if there was any generation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was going to give victory to, we know it was this generation, right? But still, Allah didn't tell the Muslims just to rely on that. He tells them, instructs them to take every single necessary step, to make every single preparation, to take all the means at your disposal to attain the desired result. So this is why our ummah is an ummah of an act of action. It's not just the ummah of tawakkul. Okay? Because the hadith says, to i'aqil wa tawakkul, right? To tie your camel, i'aqil, to tie the camel, and have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So this is why Muslims are always exhorted in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, those who believed and did good deeds. What does that show? Yeah, he's always doing things, always taking the proper action. It's not just being at the highest level of which the Sahaba are at, having the prophet of, the last prophet, the best prophet which they had, to be the best generation which the Prophet said they were. Right? You don't ride on the favor that you expect to be given to you. You take the means and fulfill everything that you possibly can to attain success. And this is something we tell our HIF students as well, right? To plan their day so that at the end of the week they reach the target that we give them for memorization, right? Any goal that you have in life, you have to plan properly. It's not gonna happen on its own. No one is going to descend and give it to you as a little plug. It has to be worked for. And this is a Quranic principle. There's nothing for the human being except that which he or she strives for. Okay? So this striving, this preparation, this is a Quranic theme that comes up over and over again, sometimes in more clear words, and sometimes in a verse like this, where you wouldn't suspect it, but you see that it's there. So once you go to the seat, you see that the instruction is there. And this is similar to the verse from Surah Al-Anfal, verse 60, أَعِدُّ لَكُمْ أَسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ, right? Which means that prepare for them what you can in terms of strength, in terms of preparation. Do everything that you can to be as prepared as you can. And this is one of the lessons that I learned from my teacher in Syria, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect and preserve her. She told us, as they were teaching us, they were actually training us to be du'at to different countries, because I was in a group of about 60 sisters from all over the world that were there in Syria learning just for the purpose of going back to their countries to teach and to spread the message and to become du'at and callers to the Fatah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one thing that I remember that I never forgot that really struck me was she said, don't you dare try to give out this message to teach others about Islam, to call them to the way of Allah without being fully prepared, without being fully knowledgeable and well-versed in the subject that you're talking about, what you are inviting to. Okay, this is a huge responsibility and trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which the rest of creation does not want to bear, right? The mountains refuse to bear the trust, and the human being in his ignorance accepted the trust. So now the least we can do is heed this Quranic imperative to then be fully prepared to deliver in every way that we are able to. Now, just to give you a little bit of Quranic vocabulary, if you look at the word thubat, which is translated as detachment, it's the plural of ba-ba-ta, okay? Theme, ba-ta, this is the singular, the thubat is the plural of that word. And like I said, it means small groups used to refer to military company. And this is called Sariya. In military companies of the Prophet ﷺ, we call this Sariya. And Sariya is a word that you will come across in books of Sirah. Okay? So it refers to a military detachment or campaign. And believe it or not, Sharia discourages low travel even for men. This is not something that is limited to women, that they should have a mahram. Of course, a man does not require a mahram, right? Who would be the mahram of the man? But in general, Sharia encourages group activities, group ventures. You see, the salah, it is in jama'ah. The hajj, it is a communal umbah. a venture that everyone does together. Fasting, everyone is fasting right now, all over the Muslim world, right? So there's a hadith by a Sahih hadith or a sanad that is Hassan, I should say, reported in the Sunan of Abi Dawud. So this hadith is reported in the Sunan of Abi Dawud, and it is sanad is Hassan. And the Prophet here is telling us, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِالْجَمَاعَةِ فَإِنَّمَا يَأْكُلَ ذِئْبُ مِنَ الْغَنَمِ الْقَاصِيَةِ, which means the Prophet said, I exhort you to hold on to the jama'ah, to hold on to the group. Because the wolf from the herd of sheep, the wolf eats the one that is alone, the lone sheep, right? This is why we always exhort our family members, our friends, to buy their home in the right location. You know, in real estate, when you go to a realtor, not most the regular realtor, what will they tell you? The first top three things to look at when looking to buy a property, they said there are three things you need to look at. Location, location, and location. This is what they will tell you, right? Because that ultimately is going to determine all the influences that will be had upon you, all the influences you will be able to exert on others, and the long-term impact you'll be able to have in that community that you are in. Everything that you're taking and everything you're able to give out and everything you have access to is determined by your location. How does this realtor piece of advice relate to this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? This is why it is important for us to buy homes and be in a place where there is a strong Muslim community. Not just Muslims, that's not what we mean. There are plenty of weak Muslims out there who are like these lone sheep, who are as vulnerable to attack as this lone sheep is in this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But when you are attached to a jama'ah, you derive energy from each other. How many times do we find it difficult to pray tarawih at home? When we come to the masjid, you feel you have the energy to do it, right? You're able to finish the whole 8 or 20, whatever it is, right? And you look to others who are ahead of you, who are struggling more than you, with the same circumstances and the same limitations. This provides an energy inside of you that you didn't think you had, right? So the process of knows the energy of the community, the energy of the jama'ah. You will be more vulnerable, you will be more likely to fall off the wagon, you will be more likely to attack by who? Shaitan. Here it's called Bib, this is what the metaphor is, and it's referring reality for us, that is the Shaitan and his onslaught, right? So, this we can extract, one of the benefits, this is one of the benefits we extract from this verse of the Quran, and thus, again, to highlight the point that even traveling alone for men in general is discouraged, as well as just the general benefits of the jama'ah. Those are some of the things that we get from verse 71. And this is just scratching the surface, right? Because otherwise I'll be on this verse for the rest of this week, right? But this is just scratching the surface. Look at what a short verse it was. Look at how you shortchange yourselves with the English translation, right? All of this, you can, subhanAllah, it's very hard to get. Without having the proper understanding of the original and the various tafsir. Okay, now let's look to verse 72. وَإِنَّ مِنْكُمْ لَمَنْ لَيُبَطِئَنَّ فَإِنْ أَصَابَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ وَلَقَدْ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ إِذْ لَمْ أَكُمْ مَعَهُمْ شَهِيدًا. Okay, this is verse 72. Among you there is such who lags behind. Then if some affliction strikes you, he says, indeed Allah bestowed his favor upon me that I was not present with them. Okay. Now, this is talking about those people that would not join the Sariyah, that would not join the military expedition that was called upon by the Prophet ﷺ. This is what would happen is that the Prophet ﷺ, there was a need to go out to face the enemy because there was an attack or imminent danger or it had to be done. The Muslims would be called to come forth and fulfill this obligation. And some would lag behind. Some would not want to join that expedition. And you know when there's one person in the group who doesn't want to do it, you know the kind of impact it has on the others, right? So about this verse, the great Mufassir Imam Al-Qurtubi, rahimahullah ta'ala, the great Mufassir of Cordoba, Spain, the time when Andalus and Muslims, subhanAllah, had their history in Spain. So he is from Qurtuba, Imam Al-Qurtubi, and Mujahid, the great Professor of the Quran. They say that this verse refers to the munafiqeen, refers to the hypocrites, right? There are two different opinions on who this verse refers to. One of them says it refers to the munafiqeen, to the hypocrites. They are the ones who lag behind. Sayyid Qutb rahimahullah ta'ala, he also holds this view that it refers to the munafiqeen, to the hypocrites, because it says minkum. If you look at the verse, to really understand this, you have to look at the third word of the verse. وَإِنَّ مِنْكُمْ And indeed from among you. Now, when you read it just like that, it sounds like it could refer to the Muslims, right? In fact, that's what the second opinion is, which I'll get to after I finish giving you the first. So the first, it says among the Muslims, because didn't the hypocrites pretend to be among the Muslims? They did confess. They did say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Outwardly, they did say this, right? So outwardly, yes, they were among the Muslims, but they were not really Muslims. So Sayyid Qutb also says, along with Imam al-Qutb bin Mujahid, that this verse refers to the munafiqeen. So here the believers are being warned to be vigilant, not just against the external enemy, but also to those who among them stay behind and therefore by their action discourage others. That's why one of the worst things to do after you join a course is to drop out. Not to make anyone feel bad, not to point any fingers, okay? This is just something that we learn from this verse, right? Because, you know, if the other person, if your friend's not coming, then you feel less bad about not going. That's just how it is. That's just how we are. There's a psychological impact. Everyone starts to lose steam. So if you continue to come, whatever class you start, whatever venture you do, even if you're not interested anymore, or if you know everything, or if it's just a review for you, but if you make the intention just to come to keep the morale high, inshallah you'll be rewarded for that, right? Because here, the Muslims are being told to be vigilant, not to lose heart, because of those people whose actions are discouraging, right? And the leader of this, of course, was the leader of the Munafiqeen, Abdullah bin Ubay bin Salul. He was the expert, you know, one to lag behind. He would always just want to. This was his practice. And he's a great Munafiq, Abdullah bin Ubay bin Salul. And his son actually was a great Sahaba. But him himself, he was munafiq and he remained munafiq, unfortunately, until his death. And subhanAllah, when you read about him, one of the things that explains his nifaq, which was unfortunately he was never able to get out of it. You can always repent him from nifaq, right? Unfortunately, he did not. Before the coming of the Prophet ﷺ to Medina, he was about to be crowned king of Medina. And here comes the Prophet ﷺ, and there goes his crown forever. And subhanAllah, he could not digest this till his death. He'd rather die in Munafiq than submit to the call of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these are the telltale signs of the hypocrites, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were not named in the Quran. The hypocrites were not named in the Quran, right? But the Prophet knew who they were, right? He knew, and he actually told Khulaifa, one of the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, who the Munafiqeen were. So, but in the Quran, what do we have? We have telltale signs of the Munafiqeen. And these signs are here for us to check ourselves, to try to detect them within ourselves. Are we of those who lag behind? Whenever there's a class, whenever there's an opportunity, whenever there's something that will help me reach the next level, that will help me improve my Islam, that will help me get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is my reaction? Do I jump on and try my best, keep going as long as I can, or do I have this tendency to just lag behind, right? So this is something that we need to look at. And subhanAllah, one thing about those who lag behind, come graduation time, they always regret not having stayed the course. This happens almost every single time we have a graduation, every single time there's an end to the class. You know, there's always this sense of regret that, oh, I wish I'd stayed the course and achieved what has been achieved today by these others, right? This is just a taste, a small glimpse into the regret of Yawm al-Qiyamah, right? This is what these experiences are for. If you think about it, these experiences of regret and sadness and loss are actually highly beneficial because they give you a sneak peek into the regret that will be experienced on the Day of Judgment when there's no turning back. Here, every failure is an opportunity to wake up, right? And I was reading this quote, that if you want your dreams to come true, you have all you have to do is wake up. Right? You can't keep dreaming to make the dream come true. Right? To make your dreams come true, you have to wake up. And never give up your dreams. Never, ever, ever give up your dreams. And don't listen to people who tell you to give up your dreams, because they're lagging behind. And they'd like you to stay with them because that makes them feel better about being bad, about not being so good. It makes them feel better. So always strive to be with those people who make you feel embarrassed about your accomplishments, who make you feel small and lazy, right? This is what I recommend to you. Okay, so this is the first thing, the first tafsir, right, is that this verse is referring to the hypocrites. Now, in the second interpretation of this verse, Sheikh Sa'di is one of the Mufassirin who believes this verse is not referring to the hypocrites, it's actually referring to lazy Muslims. Was there such a thing in the time of the Sahaba? Yes, there was. The Sahaba were not all at one level, right? There were Sahaba who committed zina. And then there's a Sahaba like Abu Bakr and Aisha, so they were not all at the same level. So he believes that this is in fact referring to those lazy Muslims who were negligent about their duty to struggle in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And they would lag behind. And the proof he gives for this interpretation is the word, same word that was used before, minkum. So here we see, appreciate the different, the room of flexibility of interpretation that you get from the same words of the Quran, right? This is sneak peek into tafsir analysis. So he says, minkum, from among you, has to refer to the believers because they're the only ones that suit or can be identified with this title. From among you, yani the Muslims. Because the munafiq cannot be from among you. Why? Because in reality, he's kafir. Munafiq in reality, we just call the munafiqeen to distinguish them from the kuffar who didn't say la ilaha illallah versus the munafiq who said la ilaha illallah. But in reality, the munafiq is kafir, sahih? That should be clear. And they are in the lowest pit of the fire of hell. So there's no doubt about there being kuffar, right? So Sheikh Sa'di says it's not possible that minkum from among you would refer to the munafiqeen because they are really kuffar, and they can never be considered to be from among you, because you are the believers and they are the kuffar. Is that clear? This is the thought process for his tafsir, for his interpretation. And he further proves this interpretation by the verse of the Quran that will follow, which talks about the concept of mawadda, right? Which we're going to discuss in the next verse. Mawadda is a feeling of close love, relationship, affection, closeness, that only believers can share with each other. And it's from the word wud, right? This is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? What wud is, the one the all-loving, right? My video's gonna look great with her in the background, so. Okay. So since he says there can be no concept of mawadda between Muslim and kuffar, this deep sense of love and affection and closeness, therefore this cannot refer to, this cannot refer to them. They're really the, they cannot refer to the munafiqeen because they are kuffar. This is clear? So they're saying what's really being referred to are the weak believers in this verse. Is it clear? Inshallah? Okay. We'll take questions at the end if anyone is lost. I see a few puzzled expressions. So inshallah, we'll take questions at the end. So then the verse goes on to say, among you there is such who lags behind, then if some affliction strikes you, he says, indeed Allah bestowed his favor upon me that I was not present with them. This gives you insight into the psychology of this person who has lagged behind. This lazy person or this munafiq, whichever interpretation it is, this is their reaction to when they see a hardship or difficulty fall upon this person. They say, oh, alhamdulillah, this is the blessing of Allah, right, that I stayed behind, right? Indeed, Allah bestowed his favor upon me that I was not present with them, right? This is kind of similar to when you see a person struggling because of the course they signed up for, or whatever, you know, lofty goal that they have. Now they're struggling, they're not sleeping at night, their children are driving them crazy, you know, they look fatigued and exhausted, right? So when you look at that, you're like, oh, alhamdulillah, I didn't take that course. Alhamdulillah, I can sleep. And okay, putting it again, you're going to gain your beauty sleep while the other person is going to gain something much more precious, much more valuable, that whose reward is going to be everlasting, right? So so when these weak believers, they would see the Muslims, the Sahaba, being afflicted, being killed, being attacked, the children become orphans, the women become widows, defeated by the enemies. There was some defeat, of course, also. They would say that it is Allah's favor upon us and not them that we left behind. This shows how doing the wrong thing twists your thinking. They're unable to discern truth from falsehood. They're not able to see things the right way. This is the impact of wrong choices. Right? Because when you make the wrong choice and you lag behind, you have to somehow justify it to yourself. Again, it's all about making yourself feel less bad about the bad choice that you made. Right? We see this coming up over and over again. And it also shows how weak their iman is, right? If it's a munafiq, there is no iman. If it's a weak Muslim, then how weak the iman was and how weak their understanding was, right? Then how can you possibly mistake not receiving tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the incredible reward associated with struggling in His way, one of the greatest acts of obedience and sincerity, how can you regard this as a ni'mah, as a blessing? Because look at the verse, it says, قَالَ قَدْ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. أَنْعَمَ, blessing, ni'mah, blessing, right? That Allah bestowed a favor upon me. Look how they mistake a lack of tawfiq for ni'mah, right? Whereas having received the tawfiq was the true blessing, was the true bestowal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Especially when this can lead to shahada, right? Shahada is the most glorious way, one of the most glorious ways to die is through shahada. And look how they regard missing that opportunity as a blessing. Okay, now the next verse, verse 73, is actually going to help you understand verse 72 even better, which says, وَلَئِنْ أَصَابَكُمْ فَضْلٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لَيَقُولَنَّكَ أَنْ لَمْ تَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُ مَوَدَّةٌ يَا لَيْتَنِي كُنْتُ مَعَكُمْ فَأَفُوزَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. Okay, so here in verse 73, and if a bounty from Allah is given to you, he says, as if there never was any affection between you and him. Oh, would that I had been with them, I would have come by a great gain. Now this is the opposite side of the coin. When they see the Muslims receiving the bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether that is victory along with the various spoils of war, and this is really what they were interested in. It was the spoils of war, right? So when they see these blessings being received by the Muslims, then they say they wish that they had been with them, right? Then their feelings come out. Oh, would that I had been with them. Now, when you say would that I had been with them, what does this show? This shows that previous to that, you felt you were not with them. You felt that you did not belong to them. You felt that you did not belong to their community, right? That you were not part of them. So, this is what they feel at a time, a point that it's too late, right? Too little, too late. This realization is not going to, help them anyway. So for those of you that are still memorizing Quran, inshallah the graduation is on Friday. Inshallah his graduation is on Friday. Some of you are still trying to finish up your Juz, Amma, or Al-Baqarah. Inshallah, keep the goal in mind. You can do it, inshallah, right? Can't is not part of our vocabulary, right? We don't have that. So inshallah you can do it. Keep this in mind, don't be discouraged, okay? I'm sorry, I can never go on any topic that talk about memorization. My apologies, it's my own fault. Okay, so look at the next verse. Verse number 74. One thing that I want to add is, you know, trying to control one's regret when it's too late really is not going to do anything for you, and focusing on the wrong things. What were these people focusing on when they recognized the blessing of the Muslims? They were focusing on the spoils of war, right? This is what they meant when when they saw Allah blessing the Muslims with victory and spoils of war, this is what they were regretful. So even the regret to be beneficial has to be for the right things. Okay, that's another gem that we extract from this. Okay, next verse. 74, right? وَلَئِنْ أَصَابَكُمْ فَضْلٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ لَيَقُولَنَّكَ إِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُ مَوَدَّةٌ يَا لَيْتَنِي كُنْتُ مَعَهُمْ فَأَفُوزَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. This is the verse we just covered. Now the next one, 74. فَلْيُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يَشْرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا بِالْآخِرَةِ وَمَنْ يُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَيُقَتَلْ أَوْ يَغْلِبْ فَسَوْفَ نُؤْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Verse 74 means, let those who seek the life of the next world, in exchange for the life of this world, fight in the way of Allah. We shall grant a mighty reward to whoever fights in the way of Allah, whether he is slain or comes out victorious. Okay. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this great act of worship, struggling in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the himmah, the courage for that, only comes when you have sold the life of this world in exchange for the next. Otherwise, why would you give up the comforts of this world if you haven't sold this world for the next? The only motivation and true courage that is required for lofty goals, for lofty things, and this is what Allah loves for us, right? Allah loves for us to have lofty goals, to have high ambition, right? He doesn't like for us petty matters. He doesn't love those things, want those things for us. But there's some things you have to have before you can aim for al-Firdaws al-Aala. And what you have to have is courage. And subhanAllah, in my experience with students, really, that's the distinguishing factor. It's those people who will have courage and say, I can do it, before they do it. Because you have to dream the dream before it can come true, right? So you have to say, yes, I can, with courage, before you actually go and do it, right? And subhanAllah, this is honestly the difference between those who succeed and those who fail. Those who, what the successful ones do is that they have the courage, they muster up the himmah, the courage to believe that they can do it and Allah will help them. And these are the ones that are always come out on top. What do we mean? How does this relate to this verse? Yani, only those people are going to fight and struggle in the way of Allah who have sold this world for the next. That takes courage. Selling this world for the next takes courage, because you've made a choice. You've made a choice to give up temporary pleasure for an everlasting pleasure. You've chosen to give up what's easy for what is right and what is more rewarding. Right? These choices are choices that cannot be made without courage. Right? So what we're called upon to do is to sell the life of this world for the next. And once you do that, you'll have tawfiq for great things. And subhanAllah, I cannot help but think of the example of Dr. Fawzia, though some of you were at our last halaqah, right? What was the verse that changed her? For those of you who don't know, Dr. Fawzia Hamid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect, preserve her, and increase her. She's one of us. She's one of our friends, one of our students. She's actually more a student of Sister Farhana. She was taking her Quran course, and she said she came to the ayah of the Quran where it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bought the souls of the believers, and for that there is jannah for them. In exchange for the souls that Allah has bought, yani purchased from the believers, in exchange for that purchase, there is jannah for them. And she said when she reached this verse, after a year and a half of the tafsir of the Quran, she just broke down into tears and decided to have the courage to make the deal. You have to have the courage to make the deal, right? And she sold herself that day and started getting up at the Hajj time, because she's a doctor who works in the daytime, has two kids who are also members of Quran, has a family, has a profession, and she would obviously be busy with that in the day and would have to sleep in the night. So she said, the only time I had for this deal, for this purchase, was before the before Hajj. So she would get up at the Hajj time for an hour to 2 hours, and this is when she memorized Quran. And Allah blessed her. Because see, when you take the first step to Allah, when you walk to Him, He runs to you. That's true. It's real. We see people who take that step, we see Allah running towards them, right? In 4.5 years, after after the age of 40. Past the age of 40. In 4.5 years' time, she finished memorizing the Quran. Just a few weeks before Ramadan, and we interviewed her, the interview is on my Facebook page. And subhanAllah, you know, this concept of selling yourself, that you no longer own yourself, right? This is the deal that requires courage, but the rewards are so much more than what you give up, subhanAllah. And this is what we're talking about in this verse. Let those who seek the life of the next world in exchange for the life of this world fight in the way of Allah, and you have the courage to do that great struggle. And we shall grant a mighty reward to whoever fights, whoever struggles in the way of Allah, whether he is slain or comes out victorious. So this is to encourage the Muslims who may have been discouraged by the action of those who were lagging behind, reminding them of the great reward, reminding them of what awaits them. But that can only be done if you make the right deal, if you make that that contract with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm going to end with this verse, rather it's a hadith in both Bukhari and Muslim, about the one who struggles and fights and goes out in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَتَكَفَّلَ اللَّهُ لِلْمُجَاهِدْ فِي سَبِيلِهِ أَنْ تَوَفَّاهُ عند وفاه أن يدخله الجنة أو يرجعه إلى مسكنه الذي خرج منه نائلا ما نال من أجل أو غيره. Which means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken the responsibility we is guaranteed for the one who struggles in his way, for the mujahid in his path, that if he causes him to die, that if he dies, if he is slain, that he will enter into paradise, or he will return to his home that he came out of, the home, the very home that he left. They'll return to it after having received the reward or the spoils of war, whatever, both or either. So if there's a reward even if we're not slain, and there's the additional reward, worldly gain of the spoils of war. And psychologically, this has an impact when the Mujahid has been promised that if you die, you have Shahada. There's nothing better than that. And if you don't die, and you will go back to the home that you came out of. Because there's always this insecurity, will I see my family again, right? Will I be able to be with them again? Will I ever go back to my home again? So that is, here there's some consolation, some comfort being provided in this hadith, that you will go back to the very home that you came out of if you remain alive by the permission of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that was what we were able to cover today, verses 71 through 74. If there are any questions, inshallah, we can take them now. InshaAllah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.